Any questions anybody has? The more personal, the better. Yes, please.
It seemed to me that when you ended up with the pairing, it also depended on whether you made them upper right, lower left, or it would have been different if you had made it upper left, lower right.
You mean where I started numbering
yes.
from? Yes. No, that's absolutely true. And that's a very good point. Thank you for making that. It is true that the Dowker notation depends on where you start counting from. And in that example, I started with the crossing in the upper left or middle left, and then I worked my way around. If I started at the other end, I would have gotten a completely different Dowker notation. More generally, if you have a closed knot, so the two ends are not loose but they're linked together, you could start at any crossing and you would get a different Dowker notation. Luckily, the notation will still give you the same picture. So if I say over the phone, here's a Dowker notation, that person will generate a picture, which is the knot that I'm talking about. But it's not a one-to-one correspondence between pictures and Dowker notations. One picture has a whole set of Dowker notations that are associated with it. That's a very good point. I mean, one of the biggest open problems in knot theory is this cataloging all the knots of a certain size. And one of the hard things about that is trying to decide whether or not two different pictures of a knot are the same knot. The Dowker notation is a really good notation for telling whether or not two pictures are the same. You can use a relatively fast algorithm for doing that. But then telling whether or not one picture represents another picture is the really hard part, as it turns out. Yeah?
Can you explain in more detail why you only need to consider the prime numbered colorings for
yes.
the thing?
So it turns out, it's a very interesting fact, that if you have a prime, if you have a coloring, then for any multiple of that coloring, you also have one for that multiple. So if I have a tricoloration, I also have a 6 coloring, a 9 coloring, a 12 coloring. All those other ones will work. And I can just multiply the colors by that number, whatever number I'm multiplying the 3 by, and I always get one. It's also true that if you have a composite coloring, so a product of two different numbers, then there has to be one of the factors of it has to actually be a coloring. So it turns out that it's enough to just look for prime colorings to decide what the possible colorings are, because they determine all the possible colorings.
Thank you very much. That makes sense.
Good. Great.
As you say, the problem you had one end of your sheet tied to the sail and the other
yes.
end tied to the shark.
Yes.
So you couldn't actually release them without the shark running off with the sheet or something. So you were stuck there. You didn't have a tangle. You had a knot.
Yeah, in that sense, yeah. I mean, it's a very, very subtle difference, but they're very close, which is when I talk about a mathematical knot, I take a string, I tie a knot in it, and I glue the two loose ends together. On the boat, instead, I had one end fastened down and then the other end fastened to something else. Just slightly different situation, but it turns out that the mathematics involved is essentially the same. And so all the things that apply to a closed knot also apply to one of these knots where you have the two ends fastened down. And so I could use the same theory. Yeah, but it is a subtle difference.
Yeah, is it difficult computationally to work out what sort of colorings a knot has?
In general, yes. I mean, you know, it turns out so people use more sophisticated methods if you want to distinguish knots. Not all knots can be distinguished just by P colorings, but you can then do things like count how many truly distinct P colorings a given knot has. And, you know, like you notice in some of those pictures, I would have one crossing that was all green, and other pictures I'd have all the. And you can actually start distinguishing between colorings and count the numbers of P colorings and use that to distinguish between the knots. But there are pretty fast techniques for actually determining what P colorings a given knot has. Please.
That was the most, the funniest mathematical presentation I ever seen. So that was really funny.
That's a mixed compliment, by the way. Yes.
When you go rock climbing, you make a figure eight knot when you're belaying someone. What's the mathematical reason behind using a figure eight knot?
There is actually a reason, interestingly enough, is it's a knot that has a lot of friction. So it's got a lot of surface area of the rope touching a lot of other surface area of the rope. And if you want a knot that's going to hold well when you're rock climbing, that's the kind of thing you want. You want a knot where a lot of the surface area of the rope is touching a lot of other surface area of the rope so that it's much less likely to slide and it's much less likely to move. And that happens to be a knot that has a lot of surface area touching a lot of surface area. So that's the reason that people use that, which, of course, you know, mathematicians typically don't worry about those issues. But in recent years, they have been. In recent years, mathematicians have gotten interested in questions like that.
So knot theory is a living, growing field. So can you give, like, a glimpse as to the modern advancements or kind of the modern developments in knot theory?
Yeah, so in the workshop, I'm actually going to talk, in just a few minutes, I'm going to talk about the applications of knot theory. And it turns out there are many areas in mathematics where it's just pure mathematics and there aren't any applications. Knot theory is not one of those. Knot theory actually has beautiful applications, as we'll see in just a minute. And so there's lots of interesting applications. In terms of the recent developments in knot theory, it's an ongoing field. There's all kinds of different things that people are proving about knot theory all the time. People are always trying to find really good algorithms. So if somebody gives you a picture of a knot, to decide whether or not it's the trivial knot, and to decide how many different knots there are of a given complexity. So we actually know how many knots there are of 16 or fewer crossings and how many different knots there are, and it turns out to be very difficult to tell those kinds of things. There's all kinds of questions. Very recent solutions to problems by a guy out of Columbia, actually, is to determine the unknotting number of knots, which we'll actually talk about in just a little while. And these have been problems that have been open for 100 years, and people are getting the results now. So it's definitely an ongoing field, and it's just exploding. So many interesting problems that people have to work on these days. So we'll talk a little bit about that in just a few minutes.